dark gunshot wounds, shot to the neck.
There's a lot of external bleeding from this neck. That could be spurty. Has everyone got face masks on? There's one hole in his left neck and there's a big swelling on the right neck.
This is certainly an extremely dangerous situation for the patient.
Get him off to sleep, Michael.
He's clinging on to life.
Would you rescue me? What about myself? When I need your love, if I need your help, would you rescue me? Would you rescue me? But I start to wonder if I'm slipping under. Would you rescue me? Would you get my back?
We're gonna staple your head back together.
There is a possibility he might die.
Gunshot to neck. Lots of bleeding. 15 minutes.
At the Royal Melbourne Hospital, a call has come through from paramedics rushing a critically injured man to emergency.
We got a gunshot wound coming in 15 minutes, shot to the neck, who's lost a fair amount of blood. Oxygen levels are low.
Emergency doctor Michael Dunn moved from Ireland 18 months ago with the dream of finishing his medical training at a major trauma hospital like the Royal Melbourne.
I had no family connections or friends over here. It was certainly a big move and a scary move at the time, but I wanted to do emergency medicine. I only heard great things about the Australian healthcare system, so took the plunge.
Multiple holes in the neck, apparently. Sats 80, heart rate 120.
Director of Emergency Mark Putland has been a physician for 20 years. He's seen more gunshot injuries than most doctors in Australia, having spent time in the US hospital system.
I was in the States for 4 months. I was observing, looking at trauma systems and how they work. There, it's a daily thing. So we have to really work hard to bring the whole system together, make sure it works well for this.
What do you want me to do?
I want to do the right chest tube.
Yes.
We'll be prepared for that and get trauma to the left.
Yeah.
Because we should assume that they're going to need one.
Gunshot wound to the neck is a very high-risk injury. There's a lot of important structures very close together in the neck. Potentially major vascular injury, so the big arteries, veins running up and down to the brain, which has pretty dire consequences, both in terms of supply to the brain and just loss of blood.
Dr. Mark is gathering a crack team of specialists to treat the gunshot victim.
G'day, how are you? G'day. My brother, Eddie, director, hey. So I'm going to team lead. Rose is going to provide surgical expertise to the procedural people because there's potential for a bit of procedural. You're what, ENT, did
ENT,
you say?
Yeah.
Hence the glasses, great. We also had the head of anaesthetics down, which is fantastic. Probably one of the best people to be managing that upper airway they've got in the whole place. Has everyone got face masks on? There's a lot of external bleeding from this neck, according to the radio. That could be spurty.
Up on the hospital rooftop, another urgent case is arriving at emergency. An air ambulance is landing with a young man badly injured in a car crash during cold and wet weather.
Is it really cold in here today?
It's freezing. I've had to put extra gowns on.
Senior emergency doctor Jonathan Papson is standing by with his trauma team.
Sounds like he's gone surfing, he's come back in the rain. Someone's just pulled out ahead of him and he's crashed into the side of them. He's been trapped in his car. He's been stuck in there for half an hour.
Usually when it comes via helicopter, it's pretty serious. It's a serious deal.
Oh, here we go.
24-year-old uni student Taylor was pinned in his crashed van in freezing conditions and is in a lot of pain.
We're going to move across and have a look at you, mate. All right? Mm-hmm. You feeling OK?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah? Good?
Yeah, a bit better.
One, two, three. Mm-hmm. All right, one, two, three.
So Taylor's normally well, driving a high ace van. T-boned the car that cut in front of him. Got full recollection of the event. He was trapped for about 40 minutes. The first ambulance crew arrived, so he was sort of spread eagle over the top of the steering wheel,
yeah,
with his chest resting on it. there is some damage to the steering wheel
as
well.
Okay. All right.
Injury-wise, is apart from a little bit of bleeding from his nose, there's no obvious injury to his face, his head.
Yep.
Nick's got no pain.
Got the wound on the leg.
Is an injury in there, which looks like a bit of dashboard's gone in and out again. There's just a steady ooze of blood coming out of it. He has a little bit cold because it was quite cold.
Yeah, cold and wet.
Taylor's very lucky. A lot of people wouldn't survive this sort of crash, especially with the country road, high speed, wet conditions, older car. You know, roll the dice.
Taylor's father arrived at the crash site as his son was being cut from the van. His parents are on their way.
Does that hurt?
No.
Did you hit the steering wheel with your chest?
Oh, I'd assume the airbag didn't go off. So.
You had a seatbelt on?
Yeah.
Does it hurt when you breathe?
No.
Did you hit your face on something?
Probably the steering wheel.
With no other obvious external injuries, Dr. Jonathan turns his attention to Taylor's leg, which had been bent up against and then pierced by the dashboard of his crashed van.
So it's probably broken, isn't it? A little bit of ooze coming out.
Is that sore, mate?
No.
Looks like an open fracture bleeding.
So an open fracture is where the fractured bone is exposed to the environment, which means it's just going to get infected unless you do something about it. And it's a bad thing to happen.
The injury is potentially devastating for Taylor, who works as a surf coach and has important uni exams coming up.
And your leg's quite sore, yeah?
Yeah, both of them.
Yeah, both.
What about those toes?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, that's my big toe.
Big
toe's really sore?
And the neck.
Both toes numb? Both feet? Or one?
These are sore, those are kind of numb.
Does that hurt?
For something like this, what are the real problems going to be? It's going to be chances of infection. Is there a problem with the blood supply to the toes? Has the main artery down there been compromised by the fracture, by the bones moving?
So the fast is looking normal. And the chest looks normal.
If it's an open fracture, which means he's got bone poking out, then there's always a potential amputation. So there's always a potential that he's going to lose his leg. That's the real deal here.
All right, so a quick summary before we get the patient. 50-year-old male, gunshot wound to neck, multiple holes in the neck, a lot of external bleeding, hence the face shields.
Back in trauma two, Dr. Mark has assembled a highly specialised team ready to treat a critically injured gunshot victim who's been rushed to emergency by paramedics.
Everyone's elevated, everyone's a bit nervous. And I mean, it's important that people take that nervousness and turn it into a positive feeling for themselves, because that same adrenaline, that can be terror or it can be excitement.
You train for this, you train for dealing with the unexpected. You do see things for the first time. So you have to be prepared and dynamic and adapt.
Sats at 80%, heart rate 120, blood pressure 140, GCS 15. That was about 10 minutes ago. A lot could have changed since then. Lisa, you get in charge of the airway for the time being. When anesthetics arrive and take the top end, if you move to a potential surgical airway, that'd be great. And Rose will be there to support you with surgical assistance with that. Michael, if you take care of the right finger thoracostomy, David, you're taking care of the left finger thoracostomy. And Thomas, you're going to have a look at the heart and then the rest of the abdomen on the fast scan for us. Thank you.
Bullets do a hell of a lot of damage. So anything's possible, but we're prepared for big airway injuries. There's a lot of things that keep a person alive packed into the neck, so it's critical.
Just arrived and looking pretty crap.
This is Nathan. Carlin is 50s, no previous medical history, meds or allergies. He has received a single gunshot wound to the left side of the neck, just under the angle of the jaw, with apparent track through to the contralateral side with increasing swelling on the right-hand side. So, airway is my primary concern. Although it is intact at the moment, he has increasing dysphagia, presumably to the swelling. There is no external hemorrhage.
So, single entry wound, is it?
Well, there's one hole in his left neck and there's a big swelling on the right neck.
Okay, his trachea is midline, chest is good, area movement below. Let's get a fast on.
Good.
There's a wound to the left side of the patient's neck with no exit wound that I can find. So I suspect the bullet's still within the patient's neck and he could die from that injury.
This is Nathan. Nolan is 50s. He has received a single gunshot wound to the left side of the neck, just under the angle of the jaw.
At the Royal Melbourne Hospital, Dr. Mark Putland and his trauma team are trying to save the life of a man shot at close range.
Let's assess his chest and abdomen in the normal way. Minimal handling around his neck, and we'll let anaesthetics have a look, and we'll make a controlled plan at whether or not we secure the airway now.
His main issue initially was his airway was a bit threatened. You get a big swelling developing from that pushes your windpipe across to one side.
The risk with this sort of injury is that the only thing keeping the man's airway open is his own muscle tone and his own, basically, he's sort of clinging on to life.
What's the front of neck look like if it comes to it, Michael?
The front neck looks okay, actually. It's all predominantly the side of the neck, yeah. Shouldn't be any issue. I think we need to go surgical airway.
A surgical airway involves making a cut into the throat so the man can breathe through a tube. But it's a very risky procedure, as the doctors haven't found the bullet. Dislodging it could be catastrophic for the patient.
Point here and no exit. We're swelling on the other side, so it's obviously trapped.
You've got a lot of experts in a room, and we've got to make sure this is an orchestra, not a jazz band. Now, Anita's had a good look with the little video, and we decided to get the surgeons to make a cut to the front of the neck and put a tube in that way. All right, some local anaesthetic with adrenaline. OK, so, team, the plan at the moment is the ENT surgeon's going to do an awake local anaesthetic front of neck access.
An awake is where the surgeon cuts open the windpipe and inserts a tube while the patient is conscious.
OK, scalpel, please.
Yeah, scalpel.
It's an extreme procedure, but the swelling of the man's tongue and build-up of blood is suffocating him.
I personally have never been involved in an awake surgical airway before. Typically, it's something that we wouldn't do in the emergency department. It's sometimes done in the intensive care unit when the patient's sedated.
A little bit of pushing on the front of your neck there.
We initially enter under the Adam's apple, and the tube would probably go in about that far. It's extremely distressing and uncomfortable for the patient. It does temporarily give the feeling like they're choking, but it's life-threatening and a life-saving procedure.
He is getting agitated. That I feel uncomfortable about, I must say.
Bit of pushing it, you're doing very well.
Is the tube in?
Yeah, tube's in.
Tube's in, get him off to sleep, Michael. Get him off to sleep.
How much longer?
Give him 100.
The airway is secured, but the trauma team now has another crisis on its hands.
Arterial bleed at the base of the neck.
How old are you?
24.
Over in Trauma 1, Dr. Jonathan Papson's patient, Taylor, is waiting for the X-ray results of his right leg, which was severely injured in a car crash on his way home from the beach.
Because you're going how fast? Like 80, 100? Or?
Oh, realistically, probably 90.
90, yeah.
The X-ray results are ready and confirm Dr. Jonathan's suspicions.
So he's got a fractured shaft of the tibia, which is not a good injury to have because it's open to the environment. You can get an infection from there. So it's actually quite a serious injury to have. If it gets infected, that's big trouble.
It's a broken bone under there.
Yeah, right.
And you can tell because you see how the blood's like a little bit fatty? It's probably coming from the middle of the bone because it's got narrow.
Jonathan calls in specialist orthopaedic surgeon Dr. Patrick Elias to see what can be done to save Taylor's leg.
Looks like it's open, so it's a grade one. This is a pretty significant injury, and the complications associated with this can be limb-threatening, so we need to do an operation on this as soon as we can and insert a metal rod down the bone and use some screws to secure that rod.
We're giving him antibiotics. We're going to wash it out, but there's still a high chance this leg of his is going to get infected.
Just a wave with that?
No.
Taylor's parents, Maury and Joelle, have arrived to see their son.
So you guys just give us heart attacks, you do? Which one? You and your brothers?
Taylor phoned his dad while he was still trapped in the van.
I was doing some gardening and the phone rang and
Taylor just said, "Dad, I've had a bad accident and I think I've broken both my legs." And I said to him, "Call an ambulance." And he said, "Oh, we already have." And then he told me where he was. So I said, "I'm on the way." Driving down there, I tried to ring him back and he didn't answer his phone. Back to where I was thinking, something terrible's happened. I got down there and, you know, there were police and ambulance, everybody all around the place. And the car was just absolutely written off. He was pinned, his legs were pinned in the van and it took them a while to cut him out. I had to obviously cut the van and that, and he was in a fair bit of pain. It was cold, it was raining, it was just a shocking day.
People lose their legs all the time in crashes like that. I've seen the van, he could lose his leg. We will do everything we can to make sure that doesn't happen.
Any questions about it?
Orthopaedic registrar Dr. Timothy Chung prepares Taylor for the major surgery he's facing.
Maybe there's some risks involved. Our hope is to give you one operation, some rods, then recovery in about 6 months.
It's overwhelming news for the surf coach and uni student whose life will be dramatically changed by the accident.
So, what do you do for work?
Surf coach, I'm a student.
So you're about 6 months away from being able to surf.
It's going to be awful for him not to be able to do what he loves doing. It's totally unexpected. It's come out of the blue. It might be totally devastating for him. That's his job.
Doctors will need a CT scan of Taylor's broken leg to see the full extent of his injury before he goes to surgery.
He's going to have pins and an external device put on his bones to hold the bones in place. And then he's got a wound there that needs to be cared for, and then he's got to worry about all the other things, the tendons and the arteries and the nerves that might have been injured as well. So it's much more complex.
There's a trauma coming in. Did you want to take it, Maya?
Dr. Maya Kubert's heading to the resuscitation unit to meet a patient being brought in by paramedics.
He's young, he's 45, he's fallen over a few times, and they wouldn't normally call this in because all of his observations are completely normal. So there's possibly something that they're worried about that I'm not gathering. Maybe they're really worried he's got a head injury.
In her 5 years at the Royal Melbourne, Dr. Myers cared for hundreds of people from all walks of life.
I think there are some patients that touch a nerve more than others that will take you by surprise.
Xboxer Zane was found barely conscious on the floor by his landlady called an ambulance. He's chatting happily with paramedics as he arrives in Resus Bay 1.
These are the legends, you though, really, eh?
Thanks, mate. Did you say we're going to
So this is Zane. He's been found in a courtyard area, bleeding from the head, and the lady that lives watched him fall over two more times. He has no real event recall about what he's been doing this morning or why he fell or what he's hit his head on. He's got quite a deep T-shaped laceration from the temple, but back towards the ear down here with a gaping wound. So I can't say that's fractured, but it is quite.
Yeah, deep. Appreciate it.
Yeah.
Thanks very much.
Hi, Zane. I'm Maya. I'm one of the emergency doctors.
Hi, Maya.
Wearing funky glasses.
I was going to say, Jesus, you're trendy.
Yeah, super trendy. Do you have any understanding of what happened this morning? The paramedics have said you didn't really have much of a recollection about what happened.
No, I just had a few drinks with me mate, and then when I got up, I sort of lost my balance accidentally. I got up too quicker than I should have, and that's where I hit me head. That's all.
When did you have the drinks, buddy?
Last night.
Last night. Do you remember how many you had?
Oh, I don't know. We had like one bottle of red wine and a couple of ports.
Okay.
If there was no alcohol in our world, I would have a lot less things to do as an emergency physician. Alcohol is a big problem.
Do you drink alcohol every day or just some days?
Yeah, some days.
Some days.
I drink every day.
All right. And when you drink, do you drink a lot or a little bit?
Not much.
Not much. What's not much?
Oh, I might have a bottle of red wine, and if I drank the full bottle, that would be a big day.
Right, okay. I suspect Zane is, in colloquial terms, pissed as a newt at some point overnight. So Zane has had a lot of alcohol, which has caused him to fall over and give himself a really nasty head injury. You'll notice we've left him lying flat just in case, because I'm not sure what his blood alcohol level is, but if his blood alcohol is still really high, then my clinical examination isn't as reliable, so I'm a little bit more cautious about how I manage them. So, Zane, I just want to have a look at this wound on your head and just make sure that you're not bleeding under that bandage, OK?
Zane's a retired professional boxer with more than 140 fights under his belt. He's fallen down drunk three times, hitting his head and causing a deep gash from his temple to his ear.
Have you got a headache? Sorry, buddy. It's a pretty nasty cut, buddy. I can see your skull.
Yeah, anterior bleed at the base of the neck.
Over in Trauma 2, doctors Mark Putland and Michael Dunn and a highly specialised team are battling to save the life of a man shot in the neck.
How much volume are we getting out into the suction?
Doctors made an incision in his throat while he was awake to insert a tube to help him breathe. But the rare procedure has triggered another potentially lethal problem.
After securing the airway, we realise that the patient has some arterial bleeding from a small artery higher up. This is certainly an extremely dangerous situation for the patient. He is essentially fighting for his life, and the interventions that we do have to be done quickly and have to be done correctly.
I'm going to start the O-neg now that we've got external bleeding in significant volumes before he gets into more trouble.
We're just going to pack it now.
Just going to pack him in theatre.
The bleeding means it's too dangerous to do a CT scan to find the bullet.
Just hook it up and you're ready to go. He's got significant external blood loss now.
Time's running out for the patient and he must be rushed straight to emergency surgery.
All the activity dislodged a bit of blood clot. Plus his blood pressure went up in response to what we were doing. It was a bit stressful for him, so that may have stimulated a bit of bleeding. So then they precipitated a change of plans. Rather than secure the airway and go to CT and see what damage is done, it was secure the airway, go to theatre. Let's go.
And I might just come up just to see that everything's good.
Oh, it was pretty intense there. Thankfully, the airway is protected now, so he's going up to theatre to have some bleeding addressed.
The emergency team has stabilised the man, but he remains dangerously ill.
This is a one step in the process of actually treating the patient. So his life is still very much on the line.
Hello, Royal Melbourne ED, Megan speaking.
We have a 43-year-old male patient who sustained a fall from a piece of industrial equipment today, approximately 2.5 metres tall.
It's now late afternoon, and senior emergency doctor Sarah Whitelaw and her team are receiving a call from paramedics rushing to emergency with another man who's fallen, this time from a height at work.
At the moment, presenting in quite a lot of pain.
Royal Melbourne received, was in approximately 10 minutes.
They're not that far away, a few minutes, so we'll go into trauma one. We'll draw up some ketamine. They said he's in lots of pain, so I think we should probably have that drawn up by the time he gets here.
The man landed on his feet, and Dr. Sarah and Nurse Maddie White know this kind of fall can be fatal.
If you fall from more than a couple of metres, you can have life-threatening injuries. Certainly, if people land on their feet, you can have broken heels and their lower back can absorb an enormous amount of force.
Ready, set, go. Ross was at work today. He was climbing off the back of a compactor, which was about between 1.5 and 2 metres tall, where he's lost his footing and he's landed on the ground on his feet, followed by a secondary strike to his bottom. He's got back up after a period of time, went back to work at about 8 o'clock when there were others at work. He was in another machine and he started to complain of some altered sensation in his feet.
Dr. Sarah needs to quickly find exactly where the 43-year-old's pain is coming from.
Whereabouts is most of your pain?
My lower back.
Okay.
My groin, my hips, ankles.
Okay.
Incredibly, Ross went back to work after the accident for 2 hours, and it wasn't until his workmates arrived that he was persuaded to go to hospital.
Just don't move your neck or your head at the moment. I'm just going to have a feel. Are you sore? That's really sore.
Can you rate your pain out of 10?
When you move me, it's
10.
The team start a battery of tests, blood, ultrasound and x-rays.
I'm worried about injuries where Ross is complaining of pain, particularly in his pelvis and his groin and his legs. What I'm worried about is there a fracture in that area, particularly pelvic fractures that can be associated with huge blood loss and can be life-threatening. I'm going to pop some cold goop on your belly and we'll have a look.
Got a pain in my lower back.
Yeah, we're getting some pain relief for that right now.
Deep breath in for me, mate. Deep breath in.
We're just going to put a collar on.
Hold your head nice and still, OK?
The ultrasound isn't showing any obvious injuries or bleeding to his abdomen.
X-ray.
But Ross's severe pain is pointing to a serious injury somewhere.
We are going to roll you onto your left side and examine your back. Just keep really still for us.
1, 2, 3.
Is that sore up the top of your back? Is that OK?
Yeah, there's pain down there.
That's pain, OK. All right, what about down here? Is that sore in there?
1, 2, 3.
Where, is that in your lower back?
Yeah. That's right there.
My groin. Yeah. Oh, my groin!
So the idea is we're going to put this on, it won't hurt as much, but it will just hurt a little bit as we do it. So you're doing well.
At the Royal Melbourne Hospital, Dr. Jonathan Papson's patient, Taylor, is being prepared for major surgery. The 24-year-old surf coach is in danger of losing his leg following a serious car crash. Taylor's badly broken limb is being wrapped in plaster to keep it stable until he goes to theatre.
Trouble is when you lift the leg up, the bone sort of sags a bit and that obviously hurts. You remember the fracture, there's a jagged bit. So I don't blame him for being uncomfortable. So I can hold the plaster if you want to get the bandage. So you've got the foot.
Any lower limb injury that's open to the environment, if it gets infected, you lose the leg or you lose part of the leg. That's the real risk. So there's a risk of infection, and even despite antibiotics and the best possible treatment, it can still get infected.
We just have to have it like that because it needs to be in the right spot.
His dad, Maury, is worried about the impact on Taylor, who's studying environmental science and about to sit exams.
There are some memories in my mind, some pictures in my mind that will stay with me forever. You know, just below the vehicle, you know, there was this puddle of oil and blood and rainwater all mixed in, and that was just a horrible thing to see. It'll be no different for Taylor, though. He'll have some horrible memories as well.
Someone's looking after me. I mean, I saw a picture of the car and it's amazing you've still got legs left, to be honest.
Dr. Jonathan has done all he can for Taylor. He's now going to theatre for surgery to try and save his leg. Back in Trauma One, Dr. Sarah Whitelaw and Nurse Maddie White are still trying to find the cause of Ross's excruciating pain. The landfill worker fell 2 metres off the back of compacting equipment, landing heavily on his feet.
It's what we call a decelerating force, which can cause injuries throughout the body, and certainly people can have life-threatening injuries.
Bring your toes towards your nose. That hurts your groin, does it? Okay, all right.
Dr. Sarah's worried the 43-year-old has massive internal bleeding.
If someone's complaining of a groin pain after a fall like that, there's bones at the front of the pelvis called the pubic rami. The pelvis is actually a bone in the body that essentially holds your spine and your legs together. If they're both broken, then sometimes the pelvis itself can kind of come apart. And there's
big blood vessels that go alongside the bones, that when the bones get broken, sometimes they can shear the blood vessels and you can certainly bleed to death from a pelvic fracture that way.
It's an incredibly frightening time for Ross. He's only just returned to Melbourne to help his mum after living in Canada for 18 years.
Must be a horrible day for you.
Oh, I didn't think it was that bad.
Yeah, I know. What happens after these sort of injuries is your body has natural adrenaline pumping around, so it masks a lot of your symptoms until you relax a little bit and realise what's happening.
Adrenaline can make you do incredible things. People will do inhuman things, you know, lift cars off people. So I feel like Ross today, he's had this incredible trauma and then just got up to do all the normal things, but then he's now realised he's in a bit of trouble.
Oh, my God.
You're able to bend your knees?
They're bent, aren't they?
OK. Does it feel the same on both sides?
I can't feel them.
I'm really concerned about that lower back. I know that if Ross has lower back fractures, it's really crucial that we get Ross comfortable enough to be able to stay still and make sure that that doesn't become a spinal injury that makes him into a paraplegic.
With his pelvis strapped to restrict movement, Dr. Sarah prepares pain medication so she can get on with the examination.
Darling, little stinger, OK? Ready? One, two, three. Doing very well.
Ketamine, it's dissociated anaesthetic that you can give in pain and it just takes your mind away from the actual injury and the pain itself.
But some patients react to the drug in unusual ways.
Just keep breathing, darling.
Ross is extremely agitated and he's not coping at all.
Shit. What the f*** is going on?
Oh, look. The world looks different when you're sitting upright. I feel a bit dizzy sometimes when you've been lying down for a bit. You okay?
Just start down at the gym.
At the Royal Melbourne Emergency, Dr. Maya Cubitt is treating former boxer Zane, who has a deep gash in his head after falling over while drinking with a mate at home.
In the next little bit, I'm going to have a look at your head and see if I can stitch it up myself. You've got a few other scars on your head.
142 fights.
Yeah.
The 45-year-old has escaped any other injuries, but his head wound is much deeper than Dr. Maya expected.
You will have a scar there, but I'll do my best to keep it beautiful.
I don't think you can do much with me, Doc.
Earlier, Zane told Maya he'd drunk a bottle of wine and two glasses of port, but his blood test results tell a different story.
So your alcohol level is quite high, like, I don't know, five, six times the legal limit.
A few red wines last night. I'm not normally in bed.
Yeah, yeah. I think you were a bit more drunk than you realise, hey? Do you do that very often?
No.
No, okay. So this is the sort of slightly mum side of things. You were a lucky guy. Probably had a bit too much to drink last night, I think.
I didn't harm anybody, only myself.
Yourself, exactly. And so that is my worry, though. I just want to make sure that next time you don't hurt yourself in a more serious way. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, okay.
I think Zane is ready to have a bit of a conversation around the fact that the way he was using alcohol wasn't that safe.
As the agony of defeat. Oh, it's got a name where they...
You keep talking, I'm going to stab you with a needle and it's going to sting.
Sorry.
Can't even feel anything. I wish I had that when I was fighting and playing footy.
Have you had a lot of stitches in your life?
Millions.
It's quite peaceful doing stitching.
I know I've done it.
To yourself.
I love suturing because you take a piece of a person, like Zane, that's broken and you put it back together and you make it look whole again. And it's very satisfying to do that.
Well, any head injury is not a good head injury, huh?
Oh, I've had plenty of them.
I know. It'd be hard for me to convince a boxer of that.
Yeah, people say that boxers lose their memory, but I've got a memory like a Like a,
My daughter's into telling jokes. Her favourite one at the moment. Why did the biscuit go to the doctor?
Why?
It's feeling a bit crummy. She'll love that I told you that joke. We're done. I'll take a photo of it and then I'll show you.
Gone too far, haven't I? Really? There's no more modelling contracts. Jesus Christ, it's worse than I thought.
Yeah, you did a good job.
Need to kick up the arse.
I do think, as an emergency department doctor, it is definitely my role to highlight that the way people are using alcohol is leading to their medical issues. I hope we can start a conversation that somebody else helps them finish.
Well, if coming into hospital because of the alcohol isn't enough to do it, nothing is. I was going to see if my drug and alcohol nurse could come and have a chat with you. Do you feel open to a chat?
Oh, yeah.
Everybody makes mistakes and bad choices at times, and we all need our community around us to recognise when we're in a place that we need help, but also to challenge us to be better.
See you later, then.
Well, thank you very much.
No problem, no problem.
If you ever need anything from me, just ask.
You're a kind man. Thanks, then.
If somebody was to come back to me and say, do you remember 5 years ago you looked after me in the emergency department and we had that chat, it made me go and do something about it. I would hope that if I have 100 of these conversations, one of them results in somebody changing their behaviour and doing some hard work, which it is, to achieve that.
You're all right, it's OK.
Shit.
Yeah, you're OK. Hospital?
What the is going on?
Down the corridor, Dr. Sarah Whitelaw's patient, Ross, is having a violent reaction to the painkilling drug ketamine.
Oh, I'm scared.
Dr. Sarah gave the 43-year-old landfill worker the strong analgesic for his severe pain after he fell 2 metres from machinery, landing hard on his feet.
Sometimes they can see frightening things, they can feel like they're having a nightmare, they can feel agitated and stressed and anxious. So there's lots of things we can do to help with that. And one of those things that's really effective is just creating a bit of a calm, reassuring environment.
What happened to me?
You had a fall, mate.
When?
Fall. I think at work.
Oh, shit.
Took care of you. We're going to look after you. Okay.
Ross, do you have family at all?
Just and my sister.
Does your sister know you're in hospital today?
No.
So you're living on your own at the moment?
Yeah, I've only been here 2 months.
Dr. Sarah still doesn't know what's causing Ross so much pain. She's very worried that the loss of feeling in his legs could be a spinal injury, which could cause paraplegia.
Oh!
I know, and you feel a bit awful.
Oh, it hurts.
So they can get on with further tests, Sarah decides to give him fentanyl, a powerful painkiller.
I'm just going to give you not the other stuff that I gave you. 20 mics.
You're okay, Russ.
The fentanyl works, and with Ross's pain finally under control, Dr. Sarah reviews his blood test results.
Another thing that worries me a little bit is this gentleman's blood count is quite low, much lower than we would expect.
And the x-rays reveal more bad news.
I'm worried about this gentleman's lower lumbar spine and what we call his sacrum.
I'm going to organise a CT scan for you. I'm worried about something going on in your lower back and your pelvis.
His blood count is quite low, much lower than we would expect for a man of his age. So I'm really worried at the moment that Ross might be bleeding from a pelvic fracture, and we need to get a CT and work out if that's what's going on. People can bleed to death very quickly from a fracture in the pelvis.
In the CT scan room, landfill worker Ross is still in severe pain after falling 2 metres and landing on his feet.
We're going to just slide you across, OK? Well done. Good job. Breathe. Ross, breathe.
There's obviously something going on. He's got a lot of pain. But what I'm looking for is big pelvic fractures or lots of bleeding from that area, or a big fracture of his lower back or an injury to the spinal cord.
Hey, Ross.
While Ross waits for the results of his scan, a workmate arrives to check in on him.
It's in your lungs,
pretty sore, but yeah.
Has anyone gone to court?
Oh, my sister. I was waiting for her. Hey, sis. I'm worried about my pelvis, my lower back, because of the shock when I fell, because I fell so high. Tell Mum it's all right.
Yeah,
love you.
Yeah, that looks chronic, doesn't it?
Ross's tests have uncovered an unusually low blood count, and his CT scan results are not what Dr. Sarah expected.
Ross is extraordinarily lucky. He's in a lot of pain, and that means that he's obviously got some bruising and soft tissue injuries, but he appears to have got away without any of the really big injuries that we were worried about. He does need to get his low hemoglobin followed up, though, because it's lower than normal, and we need to go looking for why that might be.
Dr. Meyer's patient, former heavyweight boxer Zane, was brought to emergency with a deep gash in his head after falling over when drunk.
I can see your skull.
Meyer stitched the head wound, and after a night in hospital, Zane was discharged. He then made an appointment to see a drug and alcohol counsellor.
50-year-old male, gunshot wound to neck, multiple holes in the neck, a lot of external bleeding.
Dr. Mark's gunshot victim was clinging to life when emergency doctors performed a rare procedure to let him breathe.
Tubes in, get him off to sleep, Michael.
Following 6 hours of surgery, the man went to intensive care. Thanks to the surgeons, he survived and was discharged from hospital a week later.
Are you sore? That's really sore.
It was good news for Dr. Sarah and Nurse Maddie's patient, Ross, who was cleared of any serious injuries after a fall at work that left him in severe pain.
Oh, my groin!
The 43-year-old landfill worker was kept overnight with suspected neuropraxia, a type of nerve injury which generally improves over a few hours.
With Ross, it was a good outcome. Every trauma is very different and could have been really, really bad, but Ross got lucky.
He went home the next day with painkillers for his soft tissue injuries. When surf coach Taylor was airlifted to emergency with a shattered leg from a high-speed crash, Dr. Jonathan was concerned there was a risk of amputation.
If it gets infected, that's big trouble.
Jonathan cleaned and plastered Taylor's badly broken leg before an operation to try and save it. 3.5 months later, the uni student isn't back riding the big waves yet, but he has managed to dip his toes in.
So I went from not being able to take a single step, and then I actually went for my first surf yesterday. So that was pretty exciting.
His leg was saved after marathon surgery, where a titanium rod was inserted from his knee to his ankle.
This experience definitely has changed my outlook on life. I think this accident has strengthened my relationship with my dad. Like, he found it really difficult to be at the accident site and to see me in that situation.
It probably gives us a good outlook on life now. One of the police guys at the thing said to me, you know, someone up there was looking after him, and, you know, we truly believe that.
1, 2, 3.
His whole life changed.
I remember seeing him suddenly fall. I could hear him shouting out in pain.
In the blink of an eye.
It's basically burst apart. This is going to be a bit of a long road.
Tell three children their father may never walk again.
They don't understand the reason why you can't pick him up.
Powerful new emergency next Wednesday, 8:30 on 9.